We're going to now shift to, we're just going to call this emerging therapies or something. I mean, this is huge and we're going to do our best to summarize, but I know bispecifics, you know, have been a huge topic. And then of course, CAR T cell therapies. Can you give us some of the highlights?
It's a huge area. And this is one of the reasons why I've said, I'm so excited about what's happening in research in myeloma. There are lots of things coming for what we typically call triple class refractory myeloma. So when people have been exposed to and their disease has grown on the three current major classes of drugs, proteasome inhibitors, immunomodulatory drugs, and monoclonal antibodies, we're looking for more options. We have some options now, like selinexor, like belantamab mafodotin, but we want more options. And this is where a lot of the hot research is going on. And probably the biggest group of studies we saw at ASH were these bispecifics. So to keep it simple, what do we mean by bispecific? We use that word generically because it really has, it's a drug that has two arms, bi, meaning two. So with one arm, it hooks onto the myeloma cell, typically by virtue of something that's sticking out of the cell. And then the other arm engages or reaches out to a local immune cell of the body, typically a T cell, although now we're starting to do research looking at other cells like natural killer cells, but for now they're T cells, and immediately engages the T cell to help destroy the myeloma. That the real benefit of these drugs is this is just a drug we give to a patient as opposed to CAR T cell therapy, which is also very exciting. But with CAR T cell therapy, I have to take a patient's T cells out. I manufacture them, I multiply them, I give them back to a patient a month later. There's a lot of logistical challenges in doing that. And so this is kind of an off-the-shelf approach where I can just take a drug off the shelf and give it to a patient. What did we learn about bispecifics at ASH 2021? We learned lots of things, but I would put it this way. In general, we're seeing a doubling of the response rate of what we've seen so far in this space. So we've seen great drugs like selinexor and belantamab, and even this new drug, iberdomide, which is not yet FDA approved, just kind of a newer version of the immunomodulatory drugs called CELMoDs, and it was also presented. Now, and these drugs have had historically a response rate 25 to 30%. The bispecifics in general are pretty much double that. We're seeing 50 to 60 and even up to 70% with all of these different bispecifics. Point number two is that they're different. And they're different because they can hook on to different things on the tumor. We've historically looked at something called BCMA or B cell maturation antigen, something that sticks out of a myeloma cell that we can grab onto with one of these two arms. But now we have two new targets. And I know it's like alphabet soup here, Stephanie, but one of them is called GPRC5D and one of them is called FCRH5. I think they're license plates. By the way, the first time I heard these drugs, I drove to the grocery store and I was convinced the car in front of me had GPRC5D plates. But anyway, the bottom line is that there are different ways to use bispecifics. The third thing we've learned is that they do come with side effects. We have to be careful, specifically this thing called cytokine release syndrome or CRS, where the body is reacting to this because this, you know, we're playing with people's immune systems. Thankfully, almost across the board with the bispecifics, we see much lower grade and severity of the CRS than we do with CAR T-cell therapy. We're still admitting patients for their first dose or two, depending on the rates of CRS. But I could see a day in the future where we may be able to give this as an outpatient. So this is a really exciting time for bispecifics. There are different bispecifics. They're clearly very effective. We're understanding their toxicity or their side effect profile. For some, it's pretty much just low blood counts. For others, it's a little bit more involved. Some of them have effects on the taste or the skin or even people's nails. And obviously, we're evaluating all of these in clinical trial. But the last thing I would say about the bispecific, Stephanie, is that this is not way off in the future. It's quite possible that in 2022, one, I'll say possibly two, I'm not sure the second one's quite ready yet, but we will likely see one of these drugs, the one that appears to be furthest advanced now, a drug called teclistamab, which hooks on to the BCMA and a T cell, may well be available by mid to late 2022. I don't want to, again, be prophetic and think to the future, but teclistamab, talquetamab, various others are in the pipeline now, and we hope to have them available to our patients in the not-so-distant future.
I love that summary. You hit every point I think people are wondering about, you know, especially, okay, with all of this talk, when is it available? So, okay, we'll see what happens with that in 2022. Now switching gears to CAR T, and I know they're different, there's pros and cons to both. But with CAR T, what's the most exciting sort of takeaway from ASH?
So CAR T cell therapy, again, if I go back to what I described before, just using very general numbers, we saw response rates with these simple molecules or these single molecules of, you know, 25 to 30%. We doubled that when we started using or appears to be doubling in bispecifics. We're tripling that when it comes to CAR T cell therapy. We already have one CAR T approved in the form of ide-cel. And depending on how we look at those numbers, you know, somewhere around 75%, if not even up to 80% of patients will respond to that and will respond for a long time. You know, we could argue that one of the most exciting abstracts from ASH this year was the update in the next CAR T that will likely be approved called cilta-cel through a study that was called the CARTITUDE 1 study. And my good friend and colleague, Tom Martin, presented this from your neck of the woods at UCSF. And it's remarkable. I mean, there was a 98% response rate. There were only two patients that didn't respond. And even at that, there's question about how those two patients are doing. So just literally, it's hard to make hematologists have their jaws drop, but we were really quite struck by this. Obviously, there was some cytokine release syndrome and some challenges, but generally speaking, manageable. What was almost equally impressive, Stephanie, about the CARTITUDE study was not just that the response rate was at a level that we're not used to. The depth of that response was incredible as to how many people achieved minimal residual disease negativity, but how long it lasted, that the median progression-free survival has still not been reached at 2 years. So it looks like these people will stay in remission for 2 years. And that's something that we just absolutely have not seen before. Most of these patients on the CARTITUDE study, if they were not being given CAR T, sadly, would likely have succumbed to their illness within 6 to 9 months. So for them to be able to live that much longer is very gratifying.
I know there are limitations with CAR T. It's still, you have to go to a place that can actually do them. So that's a huge limitation for a lot of patients in this country. That's a huge one, but outside of that, why else wouldn't it be right for patients? And this is broad strokes, obviously, you're not talking about one particular patient.
I mean, one of the encouraging things about CAR T actually is that we seem to have more inclusiveness than, let's say, even with bone marrow transplant or stem cell transplant. So in the ide-cel study, there were patients who were older and had comorbidities that may not have made them eligible for transplant, but they made them eligible for CAR T. Right now, some of the challenging areas are, you know, patients who are significantly elderly with many comorbidities. We don't make determination just by age, of course. Right now, because of some of the drugs that we give to people to prepare them to receive their T cells back, if people have very advanced kidney dysfunction, that's unfortunately a bit of a deal breaker for many, although we're starting to evaluate that a little bit more. But you're right. The biggest issue is access. And it's not just access because they have to go to a larger center.
More choices, more options for people. Always good news. Thank you, Dr. Mikhael. Anything else in terms of this? I mean, I know we could probably go on for another hour on that, but before we shift to our very last segment, one last question on this in particular. You know, we've done so many patient stories with people who have relapsed refractory multiple myeloma, and they're always keeping their eye right on the next thing because, you know, they're going down their list. You had already said something that was eye-opening, which was in your 25 years of doing this, I mean, there's never been a more exciting year. But what would your other message, I guess, anything else you would say to these people and their families about, gosh, I'm on my second to last option, or, you know, I'm getting nervous. How should they respond to all this news?
Yeah, as I always say, I'm the realistic optimist. I use that phrase a lot in the clinic. You're not going to find a more optimistic myeloma doctor in the country than me, because it does excite me to see all of these options. I have a patient this week I'm treating on clinical trial with a very new bispecific that doesn't even use a T cell, uses a natural killer cell. So the options are extensive. The realistic part is they're not always available right away. And there are people that have very advanced disease. And so we do encourage people to get an expert opinion, to have the openness to look at different options. Sometimes we can reuse drugs that were available before, but there is true optimism about bispecifics and CAR Ts being much more available within the next year to 2 years. And I really think it's going to have a prolific impact. And as we look to the future, Stephanie, we're now going to start, and we already are doing clinical trials, bringing this much earlier to the within the disease course. As I shared with you earlier, this trend in myeloma to treat most effectively early on is really important. No, don't save that best for last. So if CAR T works that well when everything else has failed, maybe CAR T will work even better in the frontline or the early relapse setting.
Okay, so we're going to talk to you always because you're the optimistic realist, which is a great combination. It's a very important topic, which is talking about healthcare inequities and making sure that we address all the different needs. And you talked about access earlier. I know you're invested in this. Dr. Joseph Mikhael, I really appreciate it. I know, again, you're a very busy person. So thank you for spending your time with us to help patients and caregivers understand what's going on in all of this excitement.
Oh, it's always a pleasure to talk to you, Stephanie, and I really do hope it's helpful. This is a time of great optimism. This is still a very awful disease. I hate myeloma. I always say I don't treat myeloma, I treat people. And so we want to do everything we can for those wonderful people who unfortunately have been afflicted with this disease, and we'll do the very best we can for them. So thank you again for including me today.
Thank you. And for Dr. Mikhael's entire conversation, head to thepatientstory.com where you'll find human answers to your cancer questions.